The Rapture of the Church. There are many videos you can watch on YouTube about the rapture of the church. There's also many scripture verses that you can refer to with this particular topic in mind. In fact, this is what I believe is one of the reasons why there's confusion in the body of Christ as to when this event occurs. Now, in this video, I am by no means going to attempt to date the rapture of the body of Christ. And that's not my purpose, and it doesn't need to be the purpose. Nobody needs to know. However, it is good to rightly divide the word of truth. And so I want to make this video with little confusion. And since there are so many scripture verses pertaining to end times, Revelation, Daniel, several books in the New Testament, other books in the Old Testament, there are many different pieces you can pull from. But when you do pull from a lot, there tends to be confusion because this one person will say this, and then another person will say, well, this scripture over here kind of refutes that in a way. And so in order to keep confusion down, I'm just going to focus on Revelation chapters 6, 7, 8, and 9. And then I'm going to refer to Romans 11. And I believe it's enough, actually, to make my point. And so I'm going to read from those scriptures, not all of those chapters, but I'm going to read a lot of it, and I'm going to make some points along the way in order to show what I believe. Now, there are various beliefs that many people believe in a pre-tribulation rapture, where the body of Christ is taken out of the earth before tribulation occurs on the earth. And I'm not one of those believers, even though I certainly welcome something like that. Who wants to go through tribulation? However, we're promised tribulation. Every human being goes through tribulation on the earth. But unfortunately, at the end times, the tribulation becomes worse. And we're going to get to that. I happen to believe that there is a rapture of the body of Christ, but it's post-tribulation and pre-wrath. And so we're going to see that in Revelation chapters 6, 7, 8, and 9. So I'm going to start reading from Revelation 6, and it begins with the opening of the seals, where the Lamb, Jesus Christ, opens the seals. And this is commonly refers to the four horsemen of the apocalypse. It's probably not the best description, because apocalypse it tends to make you think of the wrath of God. And it's not really. I see this as the tribulation, where even though there's tribulation throughout all of history, this is where real tribulation occurs, or what you could call great tribulation. Now, I don't refer to this as the Great Tribulation. It's referred to as Great Tribulation. I'm reading from the King James Version of the Bible, and we'll get to a portion of Scripture where that is what is referred to. It's referred to as Great Tribulation. So let me begin in chapter 6 with the first seal. And it says, "And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, Come and see. And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer." Now let me elaborate on that a little bit. This person on this white horse, he has a bow, but there's no mention of arrows. So in my opinion, this man is conquering through intimidation. Okay, now the next seal, verse 3, "And when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, Come and see. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword." Now there's somebody who is actually doing killing. There's death on the earth. And now, verse 5, "And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, Come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, A measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny. And see thou, hurt not the oil and the wine." And when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, Come and see. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death, and hell followed with him. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beasts of the earth. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. Now, let me stop there. This is not, it's not speaking of every believer in heaven. It's speaking of those who are in heaven at this moment who were martyred. Okay, in verse 10, they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? And white robes were given unto every one of them, and it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little while, until their fellow servants also and their brethren, that they should be killed as they were, should be fulfilled. And I beheld, when he had opened the sixth seal, now here's a This is the turning point right here. All right, verse 12. And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. Now, that's an interesting verse, because no time in history has man ever seen the heavens departing as a scroll being rolled up. Now, every mountain and island being moved out of their places is an obvious reference to an earthquake, but we have yet to see the heavens rolled up like a scroll. And so because of this, it says in verse 15, And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains. Now, these are obviously lost people, because believers are not going to do this. Believers are not, they don't have fear in them because of what's going on the earth. They're looking for their redemption. In fact, it's happening right now, and we're going to get to that. Verse 16. And they said to the mountains and rocks, Fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? So there we have the people of the earth, the kings, the great men, all these people, they're hiding in the caves, in the rocks of the mountains. And you know, there's plenty of talk about how the so-called elite have built cities in the mountains under the earth. And I believe it's true. In fact, this scripture testifies to that a little bit here. Like people are not going to just go into caves that are dark and cold and dank and hide, shaking. No, they're already there preparing. They know bad things are coming on the earth. And so they're there thinking they're going to survive all of this. They've got their cities and there's air, clean air pumped in there, and they got food, and they think they can hold out, you know. But when they see the wrath beginning, it's like God is revealing himself. The heavens have been rolled up like a scroll, and these people are beginning to see that Jesus Christ is indeed who he says he is. And they're terrified. And so the great day of wrath has come. And so what has everything been before this has occurred? So that was the opening of the sixth seal. So I would say to you that the opening of the first, second, third, fourth, and fifth seals, that is the tribulation period, or you might call it great tribulation has come upon the earth. And believers are there during those first five seals, but it's this, if the sixth seal, and so after the opening of the sixth seals, where we see the rest of this happening, where the heavens are rolled up like a scroll and the people of the earth are terrified and they're hiding in the mountains, and then so we see, let's go over to Revelation chapter 7, and so it says, And after these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. And let me stop right there for a second, because even though that is speaking of literal wind in the physical realm, I believe it also, it's got symbology to it. It's saying that the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is referred to as a wind that blows, and you don't know where he goes, where it's going, and where it's coming from. But it's not blowing on the earth. So the Holy Spirit is gone, and he's not being poured on the earth. People are not, at this moment, people are not coming to the Lord. The body of Christ has left, and we're going to get to that. Verse 2, and I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. Now hold that thought. The servants of God are being sealed in their foreheads. This is not referring to the body of Christ. Okay, and I'm going to get to this, because the body of Christ at the same time is in heaven, and we're getting to that verse because it's happening simultaneously with the previous four or five verses that I've just mentioned after the opening of the sixth seal. And then verse 4 goes on to say that 144,000 Jews are sealed in their foreheads, 12,000 from each tribe. And then we go to verse 9, and here is the rapture. Here's the body of Christ in heaven. It says, after this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and to the Lamb. So there you have it. You've got the body of Christ in heaven. Picture it like this. The body of Christ is on the earth, and they're experiencing this great tribulation. But you know what? It's nothing to be afraid of. When you're with the Lord, yes, I know it's going to be nasty, but we got to be strong in the Lord and believe that the Lord is going to deliver us. And so, one moment we're all on the earth, and then the very next moment, all of a sudden we're in heaven before the throne. And then just picture all of the body of Christ in the twinkling of an eye, in a moment, in a split second, standing in front of the throne all together. And then we realize, oh, we're here. We've made it. And it says in verse 10, and they cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne and to the Lamb. And so the body of Christ realizes that it has come. And our salvation is complete. You know, when you get saved, I do believe that when you're on the earth and you get saved, yes, you're saved at that moment. But salvation is like a three-part thing, all right? There's the moment you get saved on the earth, and then you submit to the sanctification process, which is part of salvation, bringing you to maturity. And then when the rapture of the church occurs, boom, that's the culmination of the salvation. You've made it. It's three parts, really. And then we see the angels in verse 11. All the angels stood round about the throne and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces and worshiped God, saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen. And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they? And I said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, these are they which came out of great tribulation, and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Now, this is the King James Version, so it doesn't say they have come out of the Great Tribulation. It says they have come out of Great Tribulation. So I agree with the King James. It's not compartmentalizing a period of time and labeling it the Great Tribulation. It's saying, it is a period of time. It's when the first seal is opened all the way to the sixth seal. And so, like, it's great tribulation on the earth, and they've come out of it. It doesn't mean that believers were taken out of it before it happened. They come out of it after the sixth seal is opened. So a lot of things have already happened on the earth from the first through the fifth seals. The sixth seal is open, and then all of a sudden, we're all appearing in heaven. And so we've come out of the great, we've come out of great tribulation. And so we're standing before the throne. And verse 15 says, therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. So we're supernatural beings. There's no more physical hunger, no more physical thirst. The natural sun in the sky is not beating on us and making us sweat. We're supernatural beings with new bodies, glorified bodies. And in verse 17, for the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them and shall lead them unto living fountains of water, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Now let's go over to Revelation chapter 8. And when he had opened the seventh seal, so now we got the seventh seal being opened here. When he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. Now let me speculate on that a little bit. What would cause there to be silence in heaven? Well, the seventh seal is open, all right? And so we've got believers, the whole body of Christ is standing before the throne of God, and we've been rejoicing, but then all of a sudden God starts again with the seventh seal is open, and then there's a hush that comes on all of heaven, including the body of Christ, which is standing right there before the throne, and it's like a reverent hush. It's like, whoa, oh my goodness, we're so glad that we're here because now look what's going to happen on the earth. Because now the opening of the seventh seal is the beginning of the wrath being poured out on the earth upon people that did not repent. But who else is on the earth? Watch while we get to that. And it says, verse 3, and another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense, which came with the prayers of the saints, ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. And the seven angels, which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. The first angel sounded, and there was fire. And so now these first three angels, this is the wrath of God. So there's fire and blood and hail, and a mountain is thrown into the sea, a flaming mountain, and wormwood falls on the waters and makes the water bitter, and people died from the bitterness of the water, and the trees and grass is being burned up, a third of it, and a third of the ships, and a third of the sea life is destroyed, and it's just terrible things on the earth. And then at the end of chapter 8, an angel is flying through heaven saying, whoa, whoa, whoa to the inhabitants of the earth for the remaining three trumpets, which are about to be sounded. And so I'm going to go over to chapter 9 now and just read a little bit from chapter 9 and end it. So just one more. I'm going to mention the fifth angel sounding his trumpet in verse 9. Chapter 9, verse 1, and the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key to the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men who have not the seal of God on their foreheads. So let me stop right there. That's verse 4. And so the people that are being hurt by these locusts are all people that don't belong to God. They don't have the seal of God on their forehead. But it's saying, but they're commanded not to only hurt those who don't have the seal. But who has the seal? So the only ones with the seal of God on their foreheads here are the 144,000 from the 12 tribes of Israel. Those are the only people on the earth with the seal of God on their foreheads. Everybody else is being tormented by these scorpions. And so that's all I'm going to read from Revelation. But I want to read from Romans 11 because this brings up the whole issue of there are believers in the body of Christ that teach that there's no separate plan for the Jews and the Gentiles. And I agree, there is no separate plan of salvation. There's only one way of salvation through Jesus Christ. But when God looks at the people of the earth, he sees them in two different peoples, Jew and Gentile. We see this clearly in the scriptures, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. In the 144,000 Jews that are on the earth during this wrath are not, they're not there because they're giving an extra chance to having rejected Christ. No, they've never heard the gospel clearly. Do you know that God is very patient and long-suffering? When somebody shares the gospel with somebody else on the earth, and that gospel is not shared properly, it's misrepresented, I don't believe God says that the person hearing is now accountable. The person hearing is not accountable. There's still ignorance in that person because the gospel was just shared inaccurately. So there are plenty of people on the earth that have heard the gospel inaccurately, and God sees that there's still ignorance in those who need to receive Christ. And so I believe the 144,000 that are on the earth, they're sealed in their foreheads because God knows they're gonna believe. They've never rejected Jesus. They haven't had the chance yet to receive him, and they're going to believe. And if you don't believe that God does that, consider yourself before you were saved. You know, they say that saying, hindsight is 20/20. And it's so true. When you're a Christian, you can look back to before you got saved and see how God preserved you. He delivered you. For some people, he delivered them from death many times over. Delivered you from this problem and that problem. Because God knew that you were going to believe. You saw the grace of God and the hand of God on your life before you even believed in Jesus, when you were going your own way in life. It's the same thing here with these 144,000 Jews. God knows they're going to believe, and he's preserving them because they're going to. They're righteous. They live righteous lives, but they haven't received Yeshua HaMashiach yet, but they're going to. And so that's why these 144,000 are on the earth. And let's look at Romans 11, because Paul says this. He does make a distinction between the people of God. So when you hear the verse, the people of God, it clearly means those who belong to Jesus Christ. But those words are also used a different way. They are also used to refer to the Jewish people. And it doesn't mean they have a separate plan of salvation. It's just the way God looks at it. He's making the two into one new man, the Jew and the Gentile, making two into one new man through Christ Jesus. But on the earth, it's still Jewish people. The salvation came from the Jews. It says it in the Bible. And Jesus is from the tribe of Judah. And so in Romans 11, verse 1, Paul is saying, I say then, hath God cast away his people? He's talking about the Jews when he says his people. And this is New Testament writing. This is after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Paul goes on to say, God forbid, for I also am an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God hath not cast away his people, which he foreknew. What ye, not that what the scripture saith about Elias? I'm going to paraphrase here. Elijah, is the 144,000 that are on the earth, is it symbolic of just many, or is it really 144,000? I believe it is 144,000, because God is a God of detail. And Elijah, Paul is saying here in Romans 11, Elijah's complaining to God that they've all turned away, I'm the only one left. And God says, no, I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed the knee to Baal. And so I believe that clearly meant that there were exactly 7,000, and Elijah was part of it. There was 6,999 plus Elijah. All right. And so God has not rejected the Jews. Romans 11 goes on to talk about how the Jews were handed over to disobedience, and they were given ears that could not hear and eyes that could not see, so that the salvation could come to the Gentiles. And then eventually the Jews, the Gentiles, when those Gentiles are really embracing their salvation and who they are in Christ, great glory is displayed through them. And this provokes the Jews to jealousy. And then God turns to the Jews, and it even says that this happened to the Jews until the full number of the Gentiles should come in. Okay, and then God turns his plan back to the Jews, and he saves Israel. And there's a scripture that says, and he saves all of Israel. Now, I don't believe it means every Jew that just does whatever he wants to do, rejecting Jesus, and not too bad, you're getting saved anyway. No, it doesn't work that way. When it says all Israel shall be saved, it means all those in Israel that are the faith of their father Israel, their father Jacob, who believed the Lord, who trusted the Lord, who had issues, but God refined him, and he became the patriarch of the 12 tribes. And so this is what is meant by that. And so that's all that I have to share about the rapture of the church. And this keeps it from being confusing. I hope that it helped you to understand. There's no fear for the believer that is in Christ. And that's also scripture, that fear has to do with punishment. If you are in Christ and you really know who you are, you have no fear. God will deliver you no matter what you have to go through. Even if you're martyred, it doesn't matter. If you're martyred, boom, immediately you go home. Whatever it is, that's God's got you in the palm of his hands if you belong to Jesus. And so that's it. The rapture of the church, I believe it is post-tribulation, but pre-wrath. And it is going to happen. There will be a rapture, and I believe it's soon. So God bless you. And Lord, bless everybody that watches this video, and seal it in their hearts, the truth from your word, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.